Well, hello everybody. The time it takes, I will just use it right now. So my name is Claudia. I'm one of the founders of the Wonder, together with Michael, whom you see in a bit. Not. So anyway, I guess most of you know the Wonder already, so I will not speak a lot about the concept, about our business model or anything, but will rather try to point out the more interesting facts. So previously, I think there has been some misunderstanding. I thought I was talking about new designers and the chances they get in the internet, so I made a mix of it right now, and I was actually planning to start soon. Ah, there we go. Das geht auch nicht. It's not working. Also, Sie könnten auch klicken. Also, das ist egal. Aber es klickt auch nicht. Das weiß ich nicht. Okay. Ja. Okay. Gut. Okay. Ich rede einfach mal weiter. Okay, so who needs pictures? We can do it like that. So I was planning, yeah, so actually to tell you a little bit about the life of young fashion designers who want to become professional designers and make a living from that. So in most cases, they have, well, actually, oops, only three possibilities either, and that's what most of them are planning, is to be employed by a really big brand and to work for them, which would give them sort of security, but at the same time limit them in their creativity, because obviously they cannot design what they have in mind, but must stay aligned to the brand guidelines. Then there's what we call the sort of boutique designer, who is planning to create his own label, get investors, and become really famous, like becoming the new Lagerfeld. And then there's sort of the smaller designers who try their best to succeed in mostly local regions. So most of the time they work from home. They try to sort of sell their clothes and product at fairs and markets. But most of the time they really stay local and don't make it beyond. Obviously, some lucky ones have been selected by TV and become stars, but that's not sort of the really classical way. And since, well, Web 2.0, there are obviously much more possibilities for young designers to start their business and to bring it online, like either their own blog, their own website, or some online shops who are focusing on young designers or upcoming designers. Most of the time, unfortunately, the problem stays the same, which is that they don't get enough traffic and cannot be found. So since platforms like Etsy, ourselves, but today many, many other platforms across the globe, I think the life of young designers, crafters and creators has changed. Allowing them really to start their business with little resources in terms of money and investment, getting feedback, building up a customer base, and, which is most important for them, sort of stay in control of their label, their fashion, and their values. So otherwise, as I said before, there are many other platforms doing something quite similar as we do. So for example, folks in the UK or a little market in France, not in the high street in the UK, but also in other countries, almost in any country that you look to today, they have the little specialized marketplaces offering designers and creators with different business models, something quite similar to the Wonder or Etsy model. So the question was if the DIY market is actually sort of a niche market or if we believe that it can become a mass market. Obviously, we believe it is a mass market already, but still a hidden one and not yet totally exploited one. So looking at the figures, actually, it's like Etsy made more than $500 million in sales last year, which is certainly not yet the end of the story, but they're still growing with, I think, 70% per year. So Dawanda makes is also growing that fast, but with a slightly smaller GMV. It's sad to be that actually 63% of UK potential or UK customers are potential customers to buy handmade products, which is a lot. In Germany, the number is slightly lower, but the market is also slightly younger, and almost 60% of the people here in Germany do like crafting and DIY. Which means that most of them, at least from time to time, knit, sew, or do anything at home. So the handmade fashion retail market, so with 250 million last year as revenues, is still quite small. But considering that it's still a very new business, it has risen over the last 5 years by an average of 15% every year. So, and I think it's pretty clear that in all that, for all these figures, the web and social commerce, especially social commerce, was sort of the supporting role to make all to make it really grow. And answering the question if we think if it can become actually really a mass market, I think it was quite similar 30 years ago with the eco market, especially bio food, and it started like in the back in the 70s with some hippie inspired people who were very nature oriented, until in the 90s actually the first small bio supermarkets opened, and today we do have really big chains of bio supermarkets and supermarket brands who are sort of producing their own biological food. So, and if we look to the DIY market, we're sort of certainly still rather at the beginning, and I think it only dates back to the year 2005 that it really started. So, as we estimate that something like in 2020, there will be real DIY stores, DIY brands all over the globe. Why do we think that? Because customer awareness is changing or has changed. So today, customers are interested who made the product. So the story behind the product is becoming more and more relevant. How was the product produced? From which materials? And where was it produced? At the same time, it's about the whole commerce, and especially also the online commerce, is about evolving into required to become actually a real shopping experience. So it's not enough just to make a bargain and to buy something that you were looking for, but customers are looking for experiences and real emotions. So I guess these are sort of the products that make people either laugh or people being shocked. So for example, you can see a mouse here, which is the burnout mouse. So ideal gifts for managers and other funny stuff. And at the same time, what we're noticing online is that people obviously want to get involved. So they do not want to be the passive consumer anymore, but participate either by making their own designs or collaborating actually with designers to get personalized products. They want to be involved by talking and by interaction with other people. So for example, what you can see here is actually it's a t-shirt. Basically, it was a t-shirt with which said, "Ist mir egal, ich lasse das jetzt so," which means something like, "I don't care anymore, I leave it like it is." And then actually somebody brought it to Facebook, and since then people are actually posting things that they don't want to change anymore. They have something like more than 50,000 Facebook fans, so I think there are a lot of big companies who are still dreaming of having 50,000 Facebook fans. And otherwise you can see here some individualized gifts, so the carrot-like baby suit was a special wish by actually Wanda Wanda employee, and the designer made it for her. Otherwise, you can see it's like dolls being designed by photographs from me and Michael, and the little cat and the little other animal are actually not just a little cat. They have been designed and crafted by the photo of a real animal, and they can even be made from the hair of your real animal. So, coming back to the fashion designers, Dawanda today has quite a few quite successful fashion designers, and I think they do look and they do actually build their business a bit different to what normally is associated to a fashion designer, thinking of the Lagerfeld image. So one of the most successful ones is actually Monique. She's coming from a really small town in Thüringen and called Aue, and started her business in the kitchen of her mother and sort of building her dream. And we were thinking of quite similar to Spreadshirt, to maybe have one designer here telling her own story, but unfortunately this didn't work out. But we've made a little video from Monique, and she's going to tell here how she started her business and what's making it so individual and special. So. Okay.
Hallo liebe Dawanda-Freunde, wir sind heute im herrlichen Herzgebirge, so nennen nämlich Monique und Anke von My Dear Love ihre Heimat. Das Zentrum eurer Ideen hier.
Also wir haben immer so eine Geschichte oder so ein Thema und das spinnen wir das halt dann, dass wir auch beide irgendwie einen Bezug dazu bekommen.
Und bei der Kollektion, was ist da euer Thema? Dürfen wir es schon wissen? Verratet ihr es uns schon?
Ja, also die soll heißen Sweets for my Sweet. Mhm. Also es geht so ein bisschen um Süßigkeiten, aber einfach mehr so von Farbtönen her und von Stoffen her. Wir nennen das immer so Kalorien, die aber nicht dick machen, sondern zum Anziehen.
Sachen zugeschnitten und dann an die jeweiligen Schneiderinnen dann noch verteilt.
Wie viele Teile werden pro Tag hier geschnitten?
Also wenn es gut läuft, müssen wir eigentlich so 30 bis 40 Sachen.
Ja. Pro Tag? Mhm. Ja. Macht das denn noch Spaß?
Oh ja, ich mache wirklich gar nicht.
Ja? Den ganzen Tag schneiden?
Ja.
Was schneidest du denn am liebsten?
Zum Beispiel die Hoodies, ja. Das fetzt.
Überhaupt euer Label entstanden?
Ich habe am Anfang für Monique noch mitgearbeitet. Also Monique war eher fertig mit dem Studium als ich. Und das war so mein Studentenjob. Mhm.
Genau. Also Anke ist da so Stück für Stück mit reingewachsen und dann wollte ich sie nicht mehr gehen lassen.
Habt ihr das denn so von Anfang auch diesen Erfolg irgendwo erwartet?
Ich glaube, es war trotzdem überwältigend, dass es so gut läuft und dass wir so gut auch uns unseren Traum so verwirklichen konnten.
Und woher der schöne Name My Dear Love?
Das ist ein Modspiel, irgend so eine Modcollage. Ich wollte irgendwie ausdrücken, also wir Frauen, wir lieben ja unsere Anziehsachen. Und da sollte eben Liebe mit rein und dann hat sich das als Wortspiel ergeben.
Und was sind denn so eure Lieblingsklamotten?
Meins ist eigentlich das Kleid, einfach weil da ein bisschen Bauch rein kann und auch unsere Hosen, die sind super bequem.
Bei dir ist es ja nicht so, dass du in letzter Zeit ein bisschen zu viel gegessen hast, sondern da erwartet uns auch demnächst eine schöne neue Kollektion, oder?
Genau, also wir fangen jetzt an, noch ein bisschen Sachen für Schwangere umzusetzen, einfach weil wir es gerade selber testen können.
Hier entstehen immer die ganzen Produktfotos für den Online-Shop und auch die Fotoshootings.
Die Models, wo kriegt ihr die her?
Großenteils Freundinnen, die mal einfach gefragt haben und gesagt, hast du mal Lust? Und haben da jetzt schon so einen kleinen Stamm, der immer wieder dabei ist.
Welche Kollektion ist das hier?
Das ist jetzt noch unsere Herbst-Winter-Kollektion. Kuckuck ruft aus dem Wald.
Hier sind wir in eurer Schatzkammer, oder?
Hier findet man eigentlich alle Stoffe, die wir momentan auch in der jetzigen Herbst-Winter-Kollektion noch verwenden.
Hier habe ich auch einen besonders kuscheligen gesehen. Ich vermute, das ist für den Winter, oder?
Das ist
Winter.
Das ist teilweise in unseren Jacken drin. Wir nennen es immer Hase, aber das ist natürlich kein Hase, sondern das ist einfach ein Plüsch.
Was wünscht ihr euch für die Zukunft?
Zum einen natürlich, dass My Dear Love als Label weiter wächst.
Genau, wir wollen das ausbauen und dann zum anderen ist es einfach auch schön hier vor Ort. Einfach, wir haben alles in einem Haus und ja, irgendwann wünschen wir uns, dass unsere Kinder mit hier unten sein können, während wir arbeiten. Das ist einfach total toll, die Möglichkeit, das zu verbinden, Beruf und Familie und Selbstständigkeit. Und die Möglichkeit bietet einen einfach auch der Wander und die Plattform.
So this was it actually, so this was the end.